is obviously the person we're really keen to see. 30 years after Life's a Riot came out, we've got A Tooth and Nail, which I think anyone who's had the good fortune to listen to will know it's, you know, it's another step in a wonderful journey. To talk to Billy, Steve Bell, who many of you know here. Steve is with the music for many years. He was the editor of Time Off magazine, one which we hold very dear here. He's now the Queensland editor of the music. He can talk about music all day, and introduce Steve to talk to Billy Bragg.
Yeah. Welcome to Big Sound 2013. It's my pleasure to welcome to you a guy that's been a massive part of my life since probably the mid-80s, like my entire adult life. Amazing songwriter, inspiring thinker, an activist, pretty great bloke really, the Barda Barking, Mr. Billy Bragg.
Thank you.
So welcome back to Brisbane, Matt.
Great to be here. I want to thank Big Sound for inviting me to come over and be here and be part of this amazing festival. Looking forward to doing a little show tonight as well.
Yeah, excellent. Bakery Lane, that'll be the most intimate show we'll get
a chance
to see you.
Yeah.
Now, you've got a long and, I don't know if it's illustrious, but history with Brisbane, going back to pre-Fitzgerald Inquiry, the tail end of the Bjelke-Petersen regime,
yeah.
When you first played here in 87. That was a pretty interesting experience from all accounts.
It was very exciting, actually. I used to play at the... I did a few shows at the East Leagues Rugby Club here. And I was talking to someone last night saying that not many British alternative bands came up to this part of the world. And obviously, myself being known for my left-wing views, you'd think, well, that might be a bit of a problem playing in Queensland. But actually, it's the absolute opposite. When you go and play in places where the politics are perceived to be pretty reactionary, because not many left-wing people go, all the lefties for miles around come out of the woodwork. It's brilliant. I once did a gig in Tucson, Arizona, and I walked on stage. It was a tiny little club. Walked on stage, sort of brag mania broke out, but I could hear someone shouting, "Red fag, red fag." I'm like, oh, trouble, red fag. So I believe you have to confront these kind of things. So I can't really see through the dark. So I'm like, so I see someone, I say, "Have you got a problem, mate?" And he's this huge guy in a singlet. And as I say it, I'm thinking to myself, are you allowed to carry a concealed weapon in Arizona? And he fills his lungs with air and he says, "Red flag, play the red flag." So, you know, you have to sort of go with different expectations. But those gigs at East Leagues were just brilliant. The audience was so up for it. And I'm pleased to say on my last trip to Brisbane, it was there was kind of still a bit of spirit at that East Leagues club. It wasn't so, perhaps not so tangible at the QPAC gig, which went great and sold out. But our ad show was at the Hi-Fi Club, which is always, it's always good when you're playing lovely municipal theatres. It's nice to do a stand-up piss and sawdust boozer. And in true East Leagues, that's a technical term, madam, I'm sorry. In true East League style, a fight broke out when some geezer pissed down the back of a woman's leg. Now, that doesn't happen Brisbane. Very much at QPAC, but it seemed to me to, it kind of, it was the standout audience event of the tour. So I think that's why it's always worth coming back to Brisbane.
Right, let's go back to the start. Obviously, your first band, Riff Raff, was between 76 and 80, and then you pulled the pin on that, and then you nearly gave up music altogether, you were saying earlier, and enlisted in the army.
I did, yeah. After being in a little punk rock band in England, things kind of petered out in 1980, and it seemed to me that all the sacrifices I've made for punk rock, like cutting my own hair, Christ, wearing skinny trousers in the East Midlands at a time when the, you know, everybody wore flares. You could get your head kicked in just walking up the streets for that. Those kind of things, wearing Oxfam clothes. All these things had come to nothing. All that had happened is the New Romantics had pushed their way onto the stage, and the music scene was returning to style over content. And this was anathema to me and my mates. So, band split up. And I thought, well, what am I going to do? I was back living at my mum's in East London, and I grew up in a town which was dominated by Fords. We had the biggest car factory in England. Everybody either worked there or their dads worked for one of the ancillary companies. And when I was at 16 at careers and I said I didn't want to work for Fords, the careers officer said, you've got three choices, son, in the Army, the Navy or the Air Force. And I was kind of looking for something to do that pressed the eject button on my abject failure to change the world through punk rock. And joining the Royal Armoured Corps and driving a tank seemed like the punkest thing to do at that point. So I signed up, and no sooner did I, but partly the reason also was to kind of like totally shred any notion of me ever being in a band or making a living writing songs, to completely turn my back on that and go away and take part in what was, if that's for me, I'm busy, take part in the what would seem to me to be the oncoming Third World War. Thatcher was just come in power. Tito had died in Yugoslavia. In Poland, solidarity was kicking off. Our government, I tell my son this, he doesn't believe me, our government was sending us leaflets through the door telling us to, in the event of a nuclear war, to hide under the kitchen table. Honestly, I mean, that was their idea. Go under the kitchen table and board yourself in and stay there for 14 days. So in that atmosphere, joining the British Army and driving a tank didn't seem such as stupid as it sounds now. But what was stupid about it was when I got there, it just inspired me to write more songs. And I realised this urge to write and to perform couldn't just be ignored. So because we have a volunteer army, you can buy yourself out at the end of basic training. So I spent my wages on buying myself out and came back and picked up my electric guitar, and really everything's been a blur really until we just walked out here just now. Since then.
At what stage did you decide to go the solo route?
Well, the solo thing, I think maybe what was my last gasp. It's funny, yesterday we announced the reissue of 30th anniversary remastered reissue of my first album, Life's a Riot, with Spy vs. Spy. And they sent me over the pressings. This is pretty old school now. I don't know if bands still do this, but they sent me over the vinyl pressings to approve. And sitting listening to it, I tried to think back to how desperate I was for that to work. This was my last go. And in some ways, going out solo was almost like fix, bayonet, and charge, and this is it, death or glory. So the fact that it, not only that it came off, but that 30 years later, people in Brisbane still give a shit about what I'm doing is absolutely amazing to me, quite frankly. No, honestly, it really is something that I'm continually amazed by, that people the other side of the world still can make some connection with what I'm saying and doing. But it was touch and go then, it could have easily just come to nothing.
I remember as a fan in the mid-80s, obviously pre-internet, we could get the music all right, but it was impossible to find out really anything about you very
probably
much.
Just as well.
you'd get the odd picture of you with the Porter stack or...
Odd pictures indeed.
you were pretty intrepid, you sort of took it all pretty full on.
Well, I think I had to really. It was kind of like it was me against the world. That's how I felt about it, And funnily enough, that's why I decided to put out Two for Now. I still feel like I've got something to say. It still feels like me against the world. But the changes that the internet has brought are just phenomenal. When I released Between the Wars during the miners' strike, not only was the strike over by the time we managed to get it in the shops in the UK, but by the time it managed to get it to Australia, the strike was history. Whereas when I released for free download my song about the phone hacking scandal, Never by the Sun, in 2011, within minutes of me uploading it in England, people in Australia could access it. That's got to be a benefit for any songwriter, but particularly for a topical songwriter. I think sometimes we tend to think that everything that's happened through digitization has been negative, but it hasn't. Obviously, it is a double-edged sword. But if you want to get your songs out there, rather than thinking that putting up songs for free download is somehow giving music away for free, it might be better to think of it like a radio session, like a John Peel session. Whenever I was booked to go and play a Peel session, I always made sure I had at least one, if not two, new songs to try. It would make me write songs, and the first time anyone would be able to hear those songs, but also tape those songs and own those songs, would be from that Peel session. And I don't really see how putting stuff up on SoundCloud or wherever on YouTube is any different from that. Mm. And my experience has been subsequently that people still buy CDs with that stuff on. I put out last year a compilation of 10 songs that I'd made available for free download on my website, and we sell it at gigs. You know, it's not either or.
You were a bit of a chancer as well early on too. Took some risks to achieve what you wanted. Like, explain how you got to be in the management stable of Peter Jenner.
Yes, I was, as I say, I was a little bit desperate trying to get some attention. I didn't really know anybody in the music industry. And I'd recorded what really was, technically was a publisher's demo, but actually ended up being Life's Right with Spy vs. Spy. And was going around to record, more or less cold calling record labels. I'd get the name of someone, I'd go there, I'd ask to see them, I'd sit in reception. Sometimes they'd come see me, sometimes I'd just leave a tape. And this particular day, I was going to see a guy called Peter Jenner, who someone tipped me up to. He'd managed to Clash back in the day. And he seemed to be, you know, someone who might be interested in what I'm doing. But I was having a bit of trouble getting past reception at Charisma Records. I was sort of sitting there in my jeans and my boots. And then a woman came out and said, "Are you the guy who's come to tune in the video, the VHS machine?" And I said, "Yeah." And she said, "Oh, come in here then." And then I was in. In my defence, I was at the time working with a mate of mine, Wiggy, who was doing audiovisual presentations. And at the time, people didn't have VHS machines everywhere. So we used to lug a big old VHS machine. And when we got to the client, we used to plug it in and tune it into their telly. So I technically, I was able, and I did tune their telly in, so they, under the telly, tuned it in so they could watch the first edition of The Tube, which Peter Gabriel was on. And they all gathered round and they all looked. So I said to this woman who tugged me in, I said, "Is Peter Jenner here?" "Oh yeah, he's over there." So I went over and blagged him. And he's still involved in my management now, all these years later.
And there's a similar escapade with John Peel, the first one?
Yeah, getting my first John Peel play was a similar blag, in the sense that when the records finally arrived, Jenner gave me a box of them, 25 brand new albums, and said, "See if you can get some radio plays on them." And I'm like, "You're a record label, aren't you supposed to do that?" And he's like, "Yeah, son, you're Billy Bragg. Nobody's heard of you. Go out and get a buzz." So I went to the BBC and I left a few albums around for different DJs, particularly for Peel, though. John Peel was a champion of outsider music, and I'd hoped that he might be interested in someone who was trying to zig when everyone else was zagging. So I left my record there. And later that evening, I was playing footy over Hyde Park with some mates. And after the show, we were standing around someone's car having a beer, and he had the radio on in his car. And the guy before Peel was a guy named Kid Jensen. And Peel had popped into Kid Jensen's show just to talk about what was on his show. And he happened to say, "I'd do anything for a mushroom biryani." And a little light went on in my head, so I quickly got changed. We were only about half a mile, Hyde Park was only about half a mile from Broadcasting House. I went down Oxford Street, popped in an Indian, got a mushroom biryani, took it to Broadcasting House and said, "Oh, this is for John Peel." And the old geezer on the door phoned him up and he came down.